coming into this weekend's game?
We had a better day today than we had last week on this day, which is, you know, a good thing. It was decent last Thursday. Today we just had fewer errors, fewer breakdowns in communication, kind of some things that we're looking for of significance today. And so, yeah, all signs, you know, are pointing the right direction.
Coach, who has earned some more playing time in, based on what you saw that first game and then this week? Who is going to get some more snaps?
Oh, gosh. I don't know. I'd have to go back and think of everybody at this point. You know, obviously the young offensive linemen, I think, will do nothing but get better just with the more snaps that they get, and that will, you know, that will continue. A lot of those young linebackers, you know, I think solidified our belief in them, whether it's Troy or a couple other guys. Lamar Winston did some good things on special teams. Brennan Schooler did some good things on special teams. And those guys, we just need to continue finding a role for them defensively, just to take full advantage of their skill set and the fact that they're playing this year.
Does your game day approach change at all when you have a team coming in that has the ball in the past four games since 2012?
Does our approach change?
Yeah.
No. We, you know, the only thing that is significant is obviously the kick time, and so we deal with that in our day. And kind of our countdown to kickoff is just, you know, literally once we find out the kick time, we're probably like the fans. We count backwards and you know, set about a plan. And but their, you know, their travels and their, yeah, we have no say in that or worry about that.
How does your game day schedule change when it's a late kick like that? Do you guys adjust things at all? If so, how?
We get them up and move around a little bit and have a little active time that's a certain time before. Basically, if the kick is 3 o'clock or beyond, we have a time in the morning where we get up and move around and not just sit around all day and veg. And so just try to stay active, keep them focused, keep them loose. And you know, obviously you're trying to peak at whatever, you know, 7:30 this week. So you just, again, have a protocol for that.
When you're scouting Virginia, given it's Broncos' first year, do you find yourself going back to BYU tape, and how much of that do you use? How much of that do you sort of rely on versus just one game?
Well, that's what's hard. They've had a ton of success for many, many years, offensively, defensively, and on special teams at BYU. So it's good in a way, but then that's also one of those things at this point, and certainly in the offseason we did a bunch of that. But you look at, you know, BYU from 2012, and they're similar to, you know, exactly how they are now, but you don't know exactly what they're going to deploy in terms of their pressures, their looks, their offense, their special teams. But you know, there's a lot of really good stuff, and so it's a good thing. But at this point, you know, as a coach, you probably start second guessing and start, well, what if they do this? What if they do that? Type of deal. And again, just worry about yourself.
Given the personal relationship that guys like Brady and guys like John have with a guy like Bronco, do you go and do you question them? Is that sort of an off-limits kind of thing when coaches and your colleagues have a personal relationship or past experience with these opponents?
No, we question them about many things, but that's not one of them. I think, you know, by virtue of there's a lot of us that have been at multiple places, a ton of crossover in the conference, ton of crossover, almost with, you know, without exception of who we play now. And so that's just kind of the incestuous nature of coaching. And but no, I mean, there's not really anything, you know, those guys, it's been a long, long time since they've been together. Yeah.
Can you clarify kind of how Brennan Schooler got here late? Obviously, John's saying he had some other offers places. Maybe he was waiting on some schoolwork. How'd you guys get him late? Because he's obviously a great player.
Sorry.
You guys like a lot.
Yeah, it was a guy that we had an eye on for a long time, and there were some things that had to get solved. Getting that solved just took a little bit longer in his case, and really, you know, through no fault of his. Bob Johnson at Mission Viejo, we've had a long, long relationship with, and trust, you know, trust him a lot. And he endorsed him beyond fully. You know, that's how kind of we stuck with him that long. And then when, you know, we thought that it was going to get done for a long time, then it finally did.
This is the first time an ACC team has ever played here. That was in the game notes. Can you walk me through the difficulty of getting a Power 5 team to come to Austin? I know this is something that always comes up, but that seemed to be a kind of an eye-opener. I didn't expect that.
Yeah, there's a ton of home and homes that we get turned down. There's a lot, you know, people want us to go somewhere three times and come here, or to a neutral site, or, you know, we've had a couple offers for two neutral sites that are east of the Mississippi River, which I'm not real good at geography, but that's not so neutral. And so it's hard, I think, you know, just that our fan base obviously has built up such a reputation. It's a smaller stadium in terms of guarantees versus, you know, Big Ten teams, Big 12 teams, SEC teams, some of these other, you know, places they just pay more. And so it's a tougher ask for some of them. But the home and homes we love, and, you know, we love to obviously play at home whenever we can.
Yeah, you guys are going to get, I think, $1 million when you guys play Auburn in Dallas 2018-2019. I mean, a little bit of a windfall that comes with that too. Is that the way you see more things going, those neutral sites to start the first couple weeks of the year?
If they work out, you know, and that's the hard thing, because then you're somebody's sacrificing a home game, you know, in some year. And we obviously, again, love to play at home as much as we can. Our conference schedule is difficult enough with the additional game, and so that's one of those things. We love to play big time games. We love to play home and homes, and we try to balance all of it.
Do you talk to your players about teams coming off a loss, Virginia losing to Richmond? Seemingly, and Matt was saying yesterday, don't underestimate a Richmond team, but a team coming off a loss like Virginia, do you talk to your guys about that much, about how UVA is going to be coming in here and playing angry or playing pissed off?
Well, I mean, sort of. I think everything we do is about us. You know, we're certainly going to talk about certain aspects of the opponent, schematically, all those things. But so much of this is us. And you know, I know Virginia was saying the exact same thing. Richmond's a really good football team, extremely talented football team. Several transfers as well as guys that you know, they recruited and are very good. And then Virginia turned the ball over and you know, they took advantage of it. And so that's plain to see, and it doesn't matter if we're playing the Denver Broncos or whoever.
Coach, after the game last week, you said a lot of the defensive problems were somewhat simple to correct. Has that been true this week? And have you seen, which is the biggest area you've seen improve this week defensively?
I think, you know, guys have just played with better pad level, better communication, and so much of the stuff, if I'm a defensive tackle or a defensive end overlapping with a linebacker and we've got three gaps to cover and we only cover two, bad things happen. And so those have been fit up better, and just the knowledge and communication and practice and all the things that you do to correct that have been better.
Coach, you guys awarded Taylor Elliott a scholarship a couple weeks ago. What was the motivation behind that?
Well, he's just worked his tail off in every realm, and you know, has been a great student. He's been a great person in the community, and just, I mean, brings it every single day. And you know, like I told the team the other night, that guy was a eyelash from starting at quarterback last year, and to last week he took literally every single scout team rep, every single one, at either tailback, quarterback, receiver. He was in every single play, and so, you know, that resonates with guys that you know, work always is credible in football and sports in general. And so I think, you know, when you reward that's a positive thing for everybody.
And him and Herbert also spent some time they were at Shelton together in high school. Have you seen that chemistry work together here as well?
I mean, I've seen them talking to each other. I think, yeah, they don't have like a secret handshake or anything that I've seen, but I'll look into it. Yeah.
Mark, I missed this. I don't know if we talked about it earlier. We talked in your Tuesday conference about the jump in improvement from week one to week two. Have you seen that this week? Much improvement? A lot?
We've been better. We've worked better. We've trained better. We've communicated better. But now we have to play better. You know, and that all has to carry over. And so many things for young guys when they're doing it the first, second, third time is it, you know, it needs to be validated in a game time situation. And so hopefully that, you know, manifests itself Saturday.
Anything else? Thanks,
Mark.
Thanks, Coach.
Did,